الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة الله سبحانه وتعالى in his قدر always has الحكمة البالغة he has an ultimate wisdom in everything that he does in his actions and everything that he legislates in his شريعة الله سبحانه وتعالى he said in the Quran وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حُكْمًا لِقَوْمِ يُوقِنُونَ Who is better than Allah as a ruler for people who are certain about the wisdom of Allah and the knowledge of Allah and the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the ultimate ruler. Allah says in the Quran, فَمَا يُكَذِّبُكَ بَعْدُ بِالدِّينِ أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِأَحْكَمِ الْحَاكِمِينَ Is Allah not the most just when it comes to ruling? No doubt that is correct. Allah is the most just. In his actions, what he does to his slaves, in their qadr, in their daily lives, and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislates in the Quran and the Sunnah and in the Sharia of Allah Azza wa Jal. And from amongst those things that show this in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is what Sahal ibn Hunayf radiallahu ta'ala anhu he mentions about a day from the days of the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Sahal ibn Hunayf said, لقد رأيتني يوم أبي جندل ولو استطع he said اتهموا رأيكم على الدين فلو رأيتني يوم أبي جندل ولو استطعت أن أرد أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عليه لرددته he said accuse your own opinions when it comes to the religion don't let your opinions come in front of the deen of Allah and the legislation of Allah and the wisdom of Allah accuse your own opinions and emotions when it comes to the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal And when it comes to the decree of Allah Azza wa Jal, because if you saw me on the day of Abu Jandal, and if I was able to reject the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's command on that day, I would have done so. This is Sahal ibn Hunayf, a companion from the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was saying, and these are the best of generations in this ummah, if I was able to reject the command, I would have rejected it from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What is the day of Abu Jandal? The day of Abu Jandal was a day when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was making a treaty, a pact with the mushrikun of Quraysh in Hudaybiyah. And from amongst the conditions of this treaty is that whoever from the people of Quraysh, from the mushrikun, from the non-Muslims, becomes Muslim, and they come to Medina to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wa sallam must reject them and send them back. Even if they're being tortured in Mecca, they have to be sent back. And whoever becomes a non-Muslim from the people of the, from the Muslims and goes back to Mecca, then we don't have to send him back. The Mushrikun said, we don't have to send him back. And so the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam agreed to this condition. All of this because of the wisdom of Allah Azza wa Jal. And the companions, they were confused. We are being stopped from doing Umrah. The Mushrikun, people are stopping us from doing Umrah. And they are rejecting our conditions. And they are giving us conditions that are unreasonable. And Umar ibn Khattab, he said, لِمَ نُعْطِي الدَّنِيَةَ فِي دِينِنَا. Why are we making our religion low? Why are we accepting these conditions? Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu later on said, I've done so many good deeds because I questioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on this day. And so when they came and they agreed on this condition, a man called Abu Jandal, he came locked in chains, tortured and beaten. Came to the, because he heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was next to Mecca. He came chained and beaten, and he threw himself in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so Suhail ibn Amr, the one who was making the contract with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said, "This is the first person you're going to send back. You're going to send back my son. This is the son of Suhail ibn Amr. Abu Jandal is the son of Suhail ibn Amr." He said, "You're going to send him back to us so we can torture him again." That's what he wants to do. They can torture him and carry on torturing him for being Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "We haven't yet completed the contract." Suhail ibn Amr said, "In that case, we have no contract." The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "In that case, please just give him to me. Just this one, we haven't completed the contract yet. Suhail ibn Amr said, "No, if you don't give him back, we have no contract." And so the Muslims are looking in this situation. They're looking at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was sent back to the Mushrikun of Quraysh. Their brother, their Muslim brother, was sent back to be tortured. But this is the decree of Allah, and Allah has ultimate wisdom in all of His decree. He was sent back to the Mushrikun of Quraysh. He was able to escape, and he escaped to a place which was the route of travel for the Mushrikun of Quraysh when they would go to trade. And he stayed there, and he set up camp there. Abu Basir joined him. A man called Abu Basir, who was also tortured in Mecca, went and joined him. The Muslims who became Muslim in Mecca and they were tortured in Mecca, they went and joined them in this camp. Every time a caravan from the trades of Quraysh would leave Mecca, on the route they would intercept the caravan and stop their trade, to the point that the people of Quraysh, they had no more trade in Syria. This is the wisdom of Allah. And so they took away this condition. They said that the Muslims can go to Medina and go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This contract was in place. This contract was in place for a number of years until the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the 8th year of the Hijrah. What happened during this time? There is no fighting because we have a peace contract. The Muslims are becoming stronger. The Muslims becoming stronger and stronger. The Mushrikun are becoming weaker and weaker. The Muslims are leaving Mecca and they're coming to Medina. Until the point where the Mushrikun of Quraysh, they broke the contract and they killed a man from the Muslims, from the tribes who were affiliated to the Muslims. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then declared war upon them and went into Mecca of 10,000 strong, taking over Mecca. All of that because of that contract that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed upon the Muslims. The one that Sahal ibn Hunayf said, accuse your own religion, accuse your own opinion when it comes to the deen of Allah, when it comes to the decree of Allah. Don't look at your own opinions. Accuse your own opinions. Because if you saw me on that day of Abu Jandal, I would have rejected the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam if I was able to, but my iman did not let me do so. If I was able to, I would have done so. Later on, he found out that that contract was the thing that was the reason for the opening and the conquest of Mecca, and thereby conquesting the rest of Arabia and the Islam spreading across the globe. أقول ما تسمعون وأستغفر الله من كل ذنب وخطيئة فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله هو الحق المبين وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين ما بعد فاتقوا الله عباد الله. My brothers and my sisters, this is a lesson for us when it comes to the deen of Allah. When Allah commands you to pray 5 times a day, you do not ask why. Allah has the ultimate wisdom in that. When Allah Azza wa Jal asks you to give 2.5% of your money in zakah to purify your wealth and to give to the charity and to build the economy and to give to the poor people. Do not ask questions about it. Do it because Allah commanded you to do it, because He has the ultimate wisdom. When Allah commands you to fast, don't eat, don't drink from the morning until Maghrib, fasting during the month of Ramadan, do not question and say why. When Allah asks you and commands you to wear the hijab, do not ask why. When Allah says grow the beard, do not ask why. When Allah says pray 5 times a day, do not ask why. All of these things that Allah has legislated, no doubt they have a wisdom. Whoever sees it, and whoever misses it, but no doubt every single action of Allah has wisdom. That's in the Sharia of Allah, the deen of Allah, what He commands us to do, but also in your own lives. And when it comes to the qadr of Allah, some decree that happens to you in your life, something hard, someone passes away, you lose your money, say to yourself, I lost my money because it wasn't good for me. I lost this thing and this person and this job and this university and this woman. I lost it all because it wasn't good for me. That's the decree of Allah. And this is the level that of Iman that the believers are supposed to reach. The level where they are pleased with the decree of Allah. Not only are they patient, something goes bad in their life, they're patient. Not only that, they're pleased, they're happy, they know that it's good for them. This is the ultimate level of al-rida, of patience that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed upon His slaves. ثُمَّ صَلُّوا وَسَلِّمُوا عَلَى سَيِّدِ الْمُرْسَلِينَ وَإِمَامِ الْمُتَّقِينَ كَمَا أَمَرَكُمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى بِهِ إِذْ قَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا اللَّهُمَّ صَلِّ وَسَلِّمْ وَبَارِكْ وَأَنْعِمْ عَلَى عَبْدِكَ وَرَسُولِكَ نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَارْضَ اللَّهُمَّ عَنِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الْأَرْبَعَةِ أَبِي بَكْرٍ وَعُمَرَ وَعُثْمَانَ وَعَلِي وَعَنَّا مَعَهُمْ بِفَضْلِكَ وَجُودِكَ وَكَرَمِكَ يَا أَكْرَمَ الْأَكْرَمِينَ اللَّهُمَّ أَعِزَّ الْإِسْلَامَ وَالْمُسْلِمِينَ اللَّهُمَّ أَذِلَّ الشِّرْكَ والمشركين اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
استووا تراصوا سدوا الخلل حاذوا بين المناكب والأقدام استووا الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى والذي أخرج المرعى فجعله غثاء أحوى سنقرئك فلا تنسى إلا ما شاء الله إنه يعلم الجهر وما يخفى ونيسرك لليسرى فذكر إن نفعت الذكرى سيذكر من يخشى ويتجنبها الأشقى الذي يصلى النار الكبرى ثم لا يموت فيها ولا يحيا قد أفلح من تزكى وذكر اسم ربه فصلى بل تؤثرون الحياة الدنيا والآخرة خير وأبقى. إن هذا لفي الصحف الأولى صحف إبراهيم وموسى. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. هل أتاك حديث الغاشية؟ وجوه يومئذ خاشعة، عاملة ناصبة، تصلى نارا حامية، تسقى من عين آنية، ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع، لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع، وجوه يومئذ ناعمة، لسعيها راضية، في جنة عالية، لا تسمع فيها لاغية، فيها عين جارية، فيها سرر مرفوعة، وأكواب موضوعة، ونمارق مصفوفة، وزرابي مبثوثة، أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت، وإلى السماء كيف رفعت، وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت، وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت. فذكر إنما أنت مذكر، لست عليهم بمسيطر، إلا من تولى وكفر، فيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر. إن إلينا إيابهم، ثم إن علينا حسابهم. الله أكبر.